Okay, so okay, it's now too loud. So we can continue with the a bit lower is better. We can continue with the with now screen time. That's something that we talked a lot about since yesterday. And as I said, it's you can see it doesn't need any special permission. It doesn't use much battery. The only thing it does is that it just captures when the screen turned on and when it turned off. It's available both in Android and iPhone. And you can see that why it doesn't need much resources. It just captures roughly around 3,000. And that's if you really check your phone a lot. That ends up like to 3,000 times per week. But it can be, depending on how often you check your phone, it can be a lot lower than that. And it's also event-based. So it doesn't, it's not that every 5 minutes the app turns on and checks how often you turned on or off your phone. Every time that you turn the screen on and off, this data is collected. It just records that. And now we can come back here and create another index pattern here for that, called ES780_screen_state, or I think it has an underscore in between. Yes.
It bears noting, in case it wasn't obvious to people, or they don't recall, this is Kibana here.
Yes.
All this is being done as part of the Kibana interface. We'll see in more detail.
Yeah, we'll see. It's the only part that I've noticed it's a bit confusing is the whole thing that you have to create an index pattern, so people don't know what that word create index pattern mean. And it basically means that just you want to connect to an index or a table of the data and look at the data there. You first have to say what is the name of it. Here we said that ES780_screen_state. That's basically exactly the name of the table that when you create a study, you notice that it took a few, like maybe 30 seconds or so, it basically was setting up these tables to store the data. It was setting up a table called Bluetooth, beacon, GPS, and everything else to set it up. Whatever we search here, it pops up because we have selected those data sources. But if this study, for example, didn't have, for example, battery data, and it would search ES780_battery, it would just return nothing because that data source is not selected, so the table for that doesn't exist. And here we can choose record time as the time filter field name. I explained this one more time what this time filter is. You noticed over on the top left, we said that show the data for the past 15 minutes, show the data for the past day or so. You basically should tell the system that when I say past 15 minutes, where to look at the data for the past 15 minutes. So basically, you say that when I say some time, go look at this field, record time, which again, as we saw in the documentation, record time is the time that this record was captured. So we say here that every time we say, every time we specify, show me the data for the past 15 minutes or for the past hour, go to this field and filter it from the past 15 minutes to now, or any other setting that we want to have. Now we create this index pattern. Now if I come here, we still see the data from the motion sensors. I'm going to delete them, and I'm going to remove those fields. I'm going to select screen state here. And as you can see, again, it has all these common fields, user ID, study ID, record time, device ID. And it has now a field state as well that basically says that at this time, the state was this. The data is written like this, that at time, for example, let's add record time and state, and maybe filter it by one user as well, user 13231. So we can read the data, so it's not from everyone. 13231. around 440 records. And you can see that actually this record time is redundant because already shows time as a record time, so these two are identical, June 24th, 2019, 11:10 and 11:10, so I'm just going to remove that here. Forget about this. Okay. At 10 minutes past 11, the screen was turned on. After around 5 seconds, it was turned off. Then again after, what's around 6 seconds, turned on, and so on, turned off, turn on, turn off. So you can see that's basically just very quick checking the phone and turning it off. This is, if you want to process this data at the moment, you have to sort the data and take the time that it's false and subtract it from the previous true value, right? Because you want to know how long it's been on. So you say at 10 minutes past 11 and 18 seconds, it was turned on, and 23 seconds, it was turned off. So the difference between these two, which is 5 seconds, is the duration that the phone screen was on. But this is really hard for processing. It can be simpler. One thing we are adding, I think, within the next 2 months, is to add an end time. So the records can be read like this. The screen was on from this time to this time. The screen was off from this time to this time. It simplifies the data analysis. You can just have all the fields in just one row. You don't have to go to the previous row or the next row to know how long the phone was off or how long the phone was on. You cannot download this data from here. We'll talk about where you can download data. If you go to you can export this data. I think somewhere has the option to export it. But what you can do that's probably easier, if you go to the dashboard, and from the data export, say you want to download screen state data, and select the participants, and you get exactly this data. We will create graphs based on using this data tomorrow that will show that for every participant, how often they check their time, their screens. And it will be like an event plot that every row will be one participant. And every time that they check their phone, there is a line there that shows how long when and for how long they check their phone. And I think just you can see that in total for we captured around 1,100 records. That's a lot fewer than what we have captured for accelerometer data and for other data sources. And maybe it's helpful to also, well, we will look at tomorrow that how you can look at accelerometer the data as well, size of the data collected, and how many records, and you can see that compared to here, that's around 11,000. That 1,100. That one is usually in the range of a few million records so far. The other one is device's battery. That's also very straightforward. Basically, it periodically samples the battery status of the phone. One record every 5 minutes. So basically, every 5 minutes, it records whether the phone is plugged in or not, how much battery it still has, how much battery it's drained. It says, for example, it says the phone is plugged and right now it's at 55%. This by itself probably is not very helpful, but it really helps when you want to combine data when you are doing analysis. For example, if the phone is plugged to an outlet, wall outlet, you can assume that the person is probably stationary and is not moving. Depends, it might be in the car and it's plugged in. But in different cases, you can use this data to help your understanding of other data sources. So by itself might not be very valuable information. You also can measure the battery drain, so how often people's phone drains battery. So some people, if they say, oh, my phone drains like in few hours, you can easily see that how much time it takes for the phone to go from 100% to almost empty to 5% or so. We can do the same here right now. Come here, create the index pattern. ES780. can see there's a level plugged or not. Again, it's also a state that you have to check what this means in here. Yeah, so zero means device is on battery, so it's not plugged. So the device was on battery, and the scale means out of 100, the level was 28. So if we also apply to only one participant, you can see it goes from 28, 27, 26, 24, 23, and that's from 11 a.m. to roughly around 12:15, within 1 hour. That's how the battery was going lower. And you can see it's actually quite flat, unlike the other ones that we had. Oops, what happened? I think I had to click on this one. Yeah. Because every 5 minutes it captures one record, and just one record. It's not that how many Bluetooth devices are around or how many beacons you can find or anything. It just captures one record. That's fine for most of these blocks, the histogram blocks, you can see that this for 30 minutes captured six records. For the 30 minutes, captured six records and so on. But it's not consistent. So sometimes it captures a bit more. And that's because when we say, this is also an important point, when we say 5 minutes, it's not exactly 5 minutes. Sometimes it can be 4.5 minutes, sometimes it can be 7 minutes. Why it can't be 5 minutes exactly? That's because when we ask operating system or Android or iPhone to run our app once every 5 minutes, it never guarantees it will run it every 5 minutes unless it's an alarm clock. So they literally have a category that say, if your app is an alarm clock, is an exception. If not, ask us how often you want, and we'll do something about it. That's why you see that there. So for example, here we had 7, here we had 5, so it's almost 5, but it's almost six readings every half an hour. That makes one every 5 minutes, but it's not guaranteed. Yes? Mm-hmm. That captures the screen time, yes, because the screen turns on and then gets turned off again.
So for those interested in screen time and assessing it very rigorously, you might want to talk with Tina back here. She has quite sophisticated machine learning algorithms to capture screen time in light of the fact that it's only there are times
The next set of sensors are environmental sensors that is turned off. This is only available in Android, and some depends on the Android phone. Not all Android phones are shipped with an environmental sensor. Like, for example, pressure sensor, ambient temperature, or humidity sensor, or proximity sensor. This proximity sensor is different than the Bluetooth beacons that's used as proximity, because they are mostly used to detect when the phone is close to the ears when you're talking. More often they are using light sensor, because when you hold the phone, that area goes completely dark, and so the proximity sensor is not really needed anymore. And so not all phones are shipped with this. I'm not sure if we have, and their data is also is not stored in Kibana. It's stored similar to accelerometer data. It's stored in separate storage. That's why if we try to access it, we can't do it through Kibana. But you can export the data right now. When we finish this, we can export the data from dashboard as CSV and see how they look. This is a graph that I had from the data that we collected, like from the sample studies. I believe this is Nate's device that had the ambient temperature, and it's a period in February that you can see that it's often close to 25 degrees, but it drops to close to zero, I think, for a short amount of time when it goes outside. And of course, temperature outside was a lot lower than zero, but probably the phone wasn't.
Probably in my pocket.
Yeah, in your pocket, in your backpack, or somewhere. That's why the temperature shows slightly higher value than the outside temperature. You can see that's around, what time is it? It's around 10 a.m., around 7 a.m., and you can read these values here. Now, a couple of communicational behavior sensors like app usage statistics, call and SMS log, internet browsing behavior. I first talk about the internet browsing behavior. That's something that we discussed with one of the teams yesterday as well. Collecting browser data is actually is not possible in iPhone. It's possible in Android if the participant is using Firefox as their browser. In Chrome, again, it's not possible to do that. That's why this data is only captured if the participant is using Firefox as their browser and they're using Android phone. And it's only limited to the URLs that they are visiting.
Yeah. So just to clarify this, so with URL capture of the URLs to which they visit, that can be done with Chrome as well?
Not anymore.
Not anymore.
We did a few studies back in 2016, 2017 that this feature was available, but I believe Android version 5 and or 6 and newer, they phased out that support. So only each browser holds only their own URL history. So whatever you see in Chrome, it's only available in Chrome and not to Firefox and so on.
Got it. In any case, it's not available in iOS.
And not available in iOS, yes. And similarly, the other two, the app usage statistics and the call and SMS logs, are not available in iOS either. They're only in Android. We can access the data here for both of them. For the first one, I think it's called app usage, ES780 app. Yes, app usage. You can see this database has quite a few more time values. But again, like we only need the record time. The other ones are, for every record, they mean something else. So we can just say use record time as the time filter, create the index pattern, and now go here. And which one is time use? Okay, the app usage. You can see here that the data that is shown, it's a bit harder than the other data sources to interpret, and that's because the way that Android provides this data is not as straightforward. The older versions of Android, Android 4 and older, they would simply tell you that this app has been used for this long at this time. For example, from 10 a.m. to 10 minutes past 10, the participant was using WhatsApp for this long. But the newer versions, I think for the past few years, they have changed it in a way that you can ask for a range of time, and then in that time range, they tell you this app was used for how long. And the lowest resolution you can use is a day. For example, you can say, today, from midnight to right now, that is like around 11 a.m., how many apps are, what apps are used, and how long each of them are used. That's the start time and end time. So basically, the way you have to read this is that from 10 a.m. of June 17th to 10 a.m. on June 18th, the camera was used for these 24 hours for 92,000 milliseconds, so around 92 seconds. The WhatsApp, this is probably me. I joined this this study as well, and my data is being captured before that. Yes. From before June 17th, yes? That's what I'm saying. This is probably the state that
this is mine, this is me.
Okay. Yeah, I need to
app
the 13.23. Oh yeah, I think the way that this happens is that when it queries the data, it starts from 1 week earlier and gets everything from 1 week earlier, comes to that point, and that's why, yeah, so this is a good point. Like, you probably have to put a filter that filters storing this data, because it stores the data for 7 days before, and it asks you to query the data for a resolution either on a daily basis or weekly basis. So you can say either for the past week or any days on that week. That's why it can tell you from 17th to 18th, which forms a full day, you can say that this was used for these many seconds. So the way that I think this component of the app works is that it starts from a week before and then captures every day to that date to cover the days that probably the app might not have been running for any reason. But then we probably have to put a filter, that's a good point. We probably have to put a filter to filter the data that's captured prior to the start time of the study. I had to, does that explain? Like, I had to filter the apps that are used for 0 seconds. If I add this, you will see that there are a lot of apps that's written that are used for 0 seconds, but they're still used. Usually these are apps that in Android is running in the background. For example, your telephony app, like basically the app that allows you to make calls, or the Android media providers. These are basically the apps that provide services to other systems and still considered apps. You can just simply exclude them. Oh, I thought it's me because I also use WhatsApp a lot. Yes. No, I turned off the filter. You see it's grayed out. If I turn it on, now it says this user doesn't have anything. I can say 13.232, I can just come and edit the filter and say 13.232, save it. Still it's disabled, I have to enable the filter as written there. Yeah, so you contributed 4,000 out of this 14. There is a different way that we can get this data from iPhone. It's more cumbersome. The way that it works is that there is a page in iPhone that provides this data, and the participants should take daily screenshot of that page, and then we run image processing on that to extract the same data from that, from iPhone as well. We're working on it, so we should have it hopefully by the end of the year, but it's not gonna be as seamless as Android, that the app does everything. The participant has to also do some work, take daily screenshots and provide that. iPhone doesn't provide any interface for us to access this data. Yeah, I'm gonna take note on that, actually.
Yeah, was that data collected by Ethica as of that date, or was it collected by the phone and Ethica simply requested?
The data, so the app, the phone captures this in a central inventory and captures how often you use what app
regardless
for how long. Regardless of what phone.
Whether you have Ethica installed or not.
Whether you have Ethica installed or not. When you join a study, the issue is that because this, if you remember when you installed this for time use, I think the problem happens here that when you add a time use, app usage data stream, it asks, or app usage data source, it asks you to install a separate application. And that application doesn't have access to the all the times that it has to collect that. So it starts from a week before and walks like day by day forward. And the problem is that, yeah, if we have to put a filter here that say when it's collected, discard the ones that are prior to the start time. I'm just gonna take note here. So you recognize based on the WhatsApp that was used or based on something else?
No, I looked at the filter, it was my user ID, like my background.
Oh, but.
But then I looked at the Android, I don't have Android, so I looked here, so I found that.
So this is not your account, actually?
No, I don't have Android.
Oh, I see. Because, yeah, this filter is disabled. It doesn't impact this, yeah. And this is data from everyone. This is data for all 13,900 records from everyone that we have collected so far. And it should not be like that. Yeah, as I said, we should put a filter that deletes the data for these periods. Yeah. That is. Well, we can go retrospectively and delete the data. That's not. Oh,
the,
yes. So my point is that we should not take the data.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah. So that's why, so the data is available on your phone, right? The data is captured and recorded on your phone.
Before Ethica is installed, that data is on that phone.
Yeah.
Ethica should not take that data from before the consent data.
Yes. That's correct, yeah. So probably the way that it should work is that when the app receives the data, before storing it, has to put this filter that it's this, exclude them, and store the rest. And then then the part, we don't have to communicate to participants that we might do this or we might do that. Say, this is the start date. From this point onward, you will have the data. Here. Oh, the other one is logs for ES780. I believe the database for that is called, let's see, 20. Oh, yes, you're right. Good catch. Yeah, 780 is telephony communications, this one. I'm going to put this here. I noticed that we don't have any of this data, so I just made a few calls in the morning to just make sure at least there's some data. Yeah, so there are some. This is also something that we are, this is a work in progress. That's why I'm not sure even if we have the information here for that. Contact location, contact network, yes. You still don't see this data here, any description of them. But basically what's available here is the phone number that's been called and the type of the contact and the length of it. The type can be a text message, an incoming text message, an outgoing text message, an incoming call, outgoing call, missed call, and so on. If it's a text message, length is the length of the message that's received. If it's a call, it's a duration of the call. The challenge here is that we need the contact number to create the network, but we also need to hash the contact number, so we need to scramble that so it's not reversible. And the way that we are working on this to make it happen is that the contact number will remain in a database with its hashed value. So when a new, for example, if I have called this number, and if I call this number 2 days later, the same scrambled value should be used both times. So there has to be a mapping table, and the table has to be destroyed only at the end of the study. So we still keep the contact network, but the contact number is not recognizable anymore. Right now, we still don't have this feature. That's why it's we haven't even added it to our documentation, and we are using this. We're still working to implement this. And the only piece of information that's personally identifiable information is the contact number. The rest is basically just the length of the message or the duration of the call and the type, whether it was missed call or incoming, outgoing, and so on. Yeah, and there's this four of them. I believe that there were like one call and three text messages. Relative record time. I'll explain, well, I probably should explain this. What the relative record time means, the record time is the absolute time that the record was captured. This record was captured today at 8:15. But if you have rolling enrollment, the duration of the enrollment is every participant's, their duration of the study is 15 days. And sometimes you want to process the data not on when the data was collected in terms of absolute time, but relative to their start time. You can say, basically this, it's long story that how you can interpret this, but this basically is a duration that says this was collected around, for example, around 6 hours after the start of the study.
After
the start of this participant joining the study. So it's like if you have rolling enrollment and participants join on different date, if you look at it, it's just like this in the, if it X is the time vector, because someone joins on June 1st, someone on June 2nd, June 3rd, this basically sets all of the time values to zero. It says everyone joined at time zero and went, then continued their participation for 15 days.
So to be clear, this provides a way of saying, you know, comparing the experiences of participants, even though they might have joined the study on different days, you could ask questions like, you know, within the first 10 days of their participation, how many questionnaires did they answer?
Exactly, yes.
But because it allows you to reason about what, for a particular person, what particular participant, what their, you know, first day is, their second day, their third day, relative to when they started in the study.
Yes, exactly. And because we store here, we say, well, this was collected at time zero, time one, time two, and so on. If this one can't properly present this, and it thinks time zero is December 31st, 1969. That's basically, in computers, this January 1st, 1970 is time zero, and this is converted to a central time zone and turns out to be 7 p.m., which is 1 hour, 18 minutes, and 34 seconds after I joined the study. I joined the study in the morning. This is 1 hour, 18 minutes after I joined, which is 1 hour, 18 minutes in milliseconds after time zero, which is shown in this format.
Yeah. It's really a time duration.
It's really a time duration, but here is, we can change the format here in Kibana to say that show this as a duration and not like this, but by default picks it up as this. We can work on that separately to see how we can look at it as a duration. The last one is variables and other physiological data, like heart rate data and other data like that. Sleep data, calories data, and so on. The way that ETHCO collects this is through contacting the application of that particular variable. Usually variables, whether it's Fitbit, it's Google Fit, Empatica, and so on, they have their own application that talks to the variable. For example, if you're using a Fitbit, you probably have a Fitbit application that communicates to Fitbit, collects your data, and stores that data on their own server. So the way that ETHCO works with this is that it will ask participants for their permission to access their Fitbit account. Sometimes if you have installed some applications that might need your Fitbit account, you see that application shows a page that it should be a Fitbit or a Google page that says, do you allow this app to access your account? And you can say, yes, I allow, or I don't allow. The way that Ethical works is that it will show a page to participant and say that we want to capture this data from your Fitbit account. Do you allow or not? When they say yes, I do allow, then every evening, then the apps, Ethical's app is not involved anymore. So they can, the app can be terminated, can be uninstalled completely, regardless of that. As long as that permission is valid, Ethical contacts the relevant data source, whether it's Fitbit, it's Google Fit, it's Apple Health, or anything else, and fetches the data and says, every evening goes to, for example, Google Fit and says, okay, I have this permission for this participant since yesterday. What new data has been uploaded? And receives that and stores the data. So far, we only have interface with Fitbit and Google Fit. The Google Fit is right now, we are doing an internal test. Fitbit, we are still waiting for their approval, because for the applications to be able to contact their servers, Fitbit has a certain approval process that we are trying to go through that. The advantage here is that even the participant uses the web-based version of the app, doesn't have the app, still can respond to the surveys and also provide this data. They don't need to have the app installed. That's a very big plus there. But of course, it increases the cost and it makes the recruitment harder, because you need to make sure everyone has Fitbit or everyone has that particular variable that works with Google Fit and so on. All of those, MiFit, I believe as well, provide an interface for systems like Ethical to communicate with them and get the data. We only have set up with Fitbit and Google Fit so far.
But Google Fit, it bears note, includes a large variety of devices, which may include MiFit.
Yeah, Google Fit does, it's not a variable itself. Any Android variable, like Samsung or Samsung Gear, I think it's called their variable, any other variable device that's Android-based, they don't have to have their own app like Fitbit. They can rely on Google Fit as a, what they call it, an aggregator. So basically, Samsung Gear, they don't want to write their own app for their variable, it's fine. They just link it to Google Fit and all the data goes there.
So Google Fit is, I believe, dozens, of devices, some of which are weight scales, some of which are, you know, things you wear on your wristband, some of which are wearables, like you have a vest or something like that, and there's a large variety, but they all meet the Google Fit standard or interfaces to be treated as Google Fit devices. And as such, they can interface with Ethica through the Google Fit mechanism. And you can go online and find lists of these devices, which are large enough.
This is the last slide about the data sources, and I just wanted to emphasize that if, for example, this is for a given participant that had all the data sources, it shows what percentage of the data uploaded was for which data source. And you can see that around 23% was for accelerometer, around 23% also was for gyroscope, then the gravity, linear acceleration, and orientation, the three software-based raw motion sensor data, are the next three, and then the orientation, and then magnetometer comes next. So the first six here, for nearly, that's 23 and 23, and then around 30% and 50. So with this another six, around 80% of the data. And then you have the next one that is light and pressure, that's the maximum, the most. And then Wi-Fi and GPS that collect a lot of data, they were roughly around 1% of the data. So if you don't need to capture these first eight, you already cut something around 90-something percent, I think. Around 93-94% of the data. And it's really important, the scale of the data that you're trying to collect, because it directly impacts battery performance and also these makes the analysis harder as well. Okay. So that's all the data. That's all the presentations that I had for the data sources. If there's any questions, we can talk. Otherwise, I think after this, we're scheduled to talk about how each of the data sources can be used in the studies that yesterday we talked about. Yeah.
So one item, Mohammed, that perhaps would benefit people's understanding when it comes to wearables. If we have a wearable, so wearables within the Google Fit standard are diverse, right? Some are wristbands that measure step counts only. Some might measure step counts and sleep, duration of sleep. Others might include, you know, like for a weight scale, a weight that's measured. So they pick up different items, and I'm wondering within Ethica, that data would first be uploaded from the app of Google Fit to Google Fit servers somewhere. Is that right?
Correct.
Ethica goes and brings that data into Ethica. Not the Ethica app, but Ethica.
To this data storage.
From the Ethica mothership, it will go access that data and bring it into Ethica.
Mm-hmm.
And so something like sleep or heart rate or steps could be brought in from that external server, is that?
Yes.
Is that correct?
Exactly, yes.
And that sleep might be labeled by a time that it applied. So over this period of time, this much sleep was obtained.
Correct, yes.
Or at this time, the participant's weight was measured on this Google Fit compliant weight scale. Or this many steps were recorded in this interval of time.
Mm-hmm.
And that data would then be in Ethica in ways that would Kibana be able to access it now or in the future?
Yes, so I'm not sure if I have this available here, but there is, let me log in on a different account, the account that we are using for our development. And here, if you go to Kibana, you can see that there will be tables specifically for those. Like for example, here I can search for calories. Calories or no, it was heart. Heart rate. Okay. Maybe I already have created that. Sleep. Oh yeah, I don't have it here. But there will be data sources here, like for sleep, for calories, the other one, heart rate. That just like what we accessed, the data will be hosted there. The data for heart rate goes to the heart rate table. The data for calories goes to its own table, and so on. Yeah, I actually thought that I have the table created here, but it's probably not yet.
Okay. So those the availability of that data could be checked via Kibana. You could look at the amounts that you have.
Mm-hmm.
And you could browse and graph the data in Kibana, as we'll see tomorrow.
Yes.
You could also download it.
You could also. Well, I was just about to talk about the download here. The easiest is to just go to sensor data and create an data export. You can see that all the sensors are here. For all of them, you can just select the format and all the participants that you want to download their data. Except the motion sensors, you can't, I believe you have to, for example, if you select accelerometer here, you can't select a range and multiple participants. You can say just for this participant, for 2019 June, export the data. And that's because the size of the data doesn't allow us to just export a wide range. You can't say for everyone in this study, for since the start of the study, export everything, because that can easily go to 100 million records. And the size of the file gets really large for data storage and then data download. So this one, for example, I said this is ready for download. If I download it here, I can open it in a, where is the finder? Tries to open it with Microsoft Excel. It doesn't work really. I have to open it with a text editor. It's probably easier. I can say open the CSV file that I just downloaded here. Somewhere here I should say don't wrap the words. But you can see that this so far for me has been 81,000 records since this morning. And the data, you can see that it has the amount, the readings in x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis. It's written from at this section. You can see while mostly the data is, the sensor is stationary, it on X and Y axis it's zero, then on Z axis it's around 10. That's the force of gravity. And then as it changes, its readings changes, of course, as well. I can't find anything here that is not 0, 0, and 9. So yeah, it's all 0, 0, 0 here as well, all zero readings, and here it's mostly 9s. So it means that the phone probably was in roughly the same position, and the rest is noise. But that's how the data for raw sensor, raw accelerometer data looks like. And the same for the other five sensors.
So for people's understanding with respect to wearables, can measure a wide variety of things. Some of those items are things that the phone also measures from different locations, typically, right? From slightly different locations, like in your pocket versus on your wrist. Something like a step cup.
Mm-hmm.
Those aren't measured by all Google Fit wearables. For example, weight and scale will measure them, but they are measured by some, like wristbands. So for step counts, how in the Ethica system or Ethica interface, is there a recognition that these are step counts, similar to how step counts are received from the phone, that both are different types of step counts, or is that not really a notion?
In the database, that's the step count.
Yeah.
It's stored on a separate table, so it's stored in a different table, and that's why we had to access them through its own. I think it was here that we had to create a separate index pattern for accessing it for pedometer data.
So
it's
there
stored.
The step counts from the phone is the main step count.
Oh yeah, I see. For that one, it's the device ID differentiates them. It says that here one of the fields that we had in here for pedometer is the device ID. That device ID basically says that whether it comes from, even if you have it in your Google Fit, Google Fit, as I said, is an aggregator. So it can come from a Mi Fit device, it can come from a Galaxy Gear, it can come from different sources. And it all go under your Google Fit account. And so here, the device ID, if it comes from a variable, the device ID says that it came from Google Fit underscore Galaxy Gear. So it's clear that this is not the one that's recorded from the phone, but the one that came from the other source.
So we might have, for things like steps, several, you know, say two sources, but it would be delineated with the device ID from which source they are getting.
Yes. But they all are stored in the one database. And that's actually like one thing that is a bit tricky on something like calorie, because there are different ways to calculate it, and there are different values that you get in each method. So, but we still try to store all of the available information in one table, so it's easier to compare them. Okay.
And similarly, if a given participant were carrying two different phones, course of their study maybe I started a 3-month study with one phone, and then I switched to a new phone.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to comment on how that is handled in Ethica?
That's also shown in a different with different study device IDs. If you actually go to if you come here to adherence, participation adherence, you can see that in a simple graph that what is the compliance rate for every participant. Like, for example, for 3951, we got some data at the beginning, but then none of the sensor data. And since they started, like basically the app was terminated, it was running an iPhone 11.8. That's not the iPhone 11, but that's internal code that iPhone uses. And their internal coding is a bit confusing. Like, for example, iPhone 8 and 8 Plus and 8S, they are called iPhone 8, 9, and 10. And then iPhone S Max and all of those, they have different internal coding. You can search what is iPhone 11.8. If I open this one, or maybe here I can find. Yeah, it's an iPhone XR. That is, the ID is also iPhone 11.8. While some of the other ones, like for example, from user 13231 and 13247, one of them is using an iPhone, and the other one is an Android device. We have all the data for all these data sources, except that we don't have any Bluetooth data for the iPhone user. And that's because, as I said, iPhone doesn't provide Bluetooth data. And if we go to Kibana, we can see the same thing as well. For this user, there is zero Bluetooth record. For this user, we had Bluetooth records all the time.
And so what if these users had multiple devices?
Yes. If, for example, you go to here, physical activity, one of the users has a lot more devices, yes. And it shows that, for example, I started with this LG phone, and then I switched back and forth between an iPhone 5S and this one, and then now I'm switching back and forth between a Pixel and a VT Arbis and Huawei device. You can also see that the data that come in, they all separately tagged with this device ID.
Very good. So if a person does carry different devices, like with wearables, would they be shown in a similar way?
We haven't completed that part yet. So, yeah. But that should be registered as a separate device, yes.
Yeah.
So I think we can, I can go more into the details of how we can visualize data, but I think it's best if we leave that for later today and tomorrow and start working on like exactly how these data sources can be used in different studies. We talked a bit about it yesterday, but we can continue that discussion today. Good? So we can continue that. I'll stop the recording here.
Okay, so
it will need your password.
Okay.
Yes.
So the different studies, which